You're listening to the Zach Gelbs Show on Fox Sports 920, The Jersey.
All right, welcome back in. 5:17 is the time from the Princeton Orthopedic Associates Studios. I'll be at the Garden tomorrow night for a game six. Rangers have to win tomorrow and then also on Thursday. But in order to get to Thursday, they have to win tomorrow as they're now down 3-2 in a series that I think the Rangers have been the better team, but that's not the case when you see the end of 60 minutes and even more than 60 minutes as it went into overtime in that game five. Rangers blow the lead late once again, and then the Ottawa Senators get the victory in overtime. And the man that will be on the call tomorrow night from MSG is John Forslund from the NHL and NBC, and he's kind enough to hop on board with us right now. John, appreciate a few minutes. Thanks for the time, and how are you?
Good, Zach. My pleasure. How are you?
Well, I'm doing great, and we appreciate you coming on. So, like I was saying, another blown lead for the Rangers in Game 5, and this was another opportunity squandered away. How about what happened in the final minutes of the third period in Game 5, as this is a series that the Rangers lose another game where you think they're probably the better team?
Well, I agree with you, and I certainly felt coming out of the first four games they were the better team, and after seeing them score the first two goals, in Game 5, it looked like, okay, they're onto it. They'll get to their game, and they'll complete this, and then take it back to New York and close it out in 6. But it doesn't happen, and I think two things are happening here. Number one, the Rangers have to be far more complete in a lot of areas, how they handle the puck, how physical they are, and not letting their foot off the gas at any point against Ottawa. And just basically, their fundamental coverage, their breakdowns, there's way too many, and then Henrik Lundqvist needs to be better in certain spots. And if they can put all of that together, then maybe, you know, they have enough to win the next two games. The other thing that's happening here, Zach, is that Ottawa looks like a team of destiny, and that's scary if you're the Rangers because they're getting bounces, they're earning their bounces, they're scoring late goals, heroic goals, and they've done it three times in the series. And that's always a situation you look at in the playoffs, and you can't explain it, but it just happens. That team of destiny rises up, and they move on. So it should be an interesting night tomorrow.
I agree with everything that you just said in your evaluation from why the Rangers are at this standpoint. One more thing to add on. Let me just preface it by saying I love the job Alain Vigneault has done in his run here in New York with the Rangers, and they've been many long months in these postseasons, and they got to a cup final, got to another Eastern Conference final, and he's gotten more out of this team this year than most expected going in. But we've seen this before in this postseason where he's not trusting some of the younger players, specifically a defenseman in Brady Shea late in the game. You didn't see him in the final 5 minutes, and he's been their second-best defender this postseason. Why do you think the trust isn't there to have him on the final 5 minutes in that Game 5?
I can't. It's an excellent question. I can't explain why, but I can explain that it probably has to happen. And both Brady Shea and Brendan Smith, I think, have been extraordinary in the series. And they deserve more ice time. They received, they went and surpassed Nick Holden and Mark Stahl in Game 3. It kind of carried over into Game 4, and you can't explain it. Sometimes coaches are reluctant to go there. He adjusted his lineup in Round 1, a little bit more of a younger approach when he put Pavel Buchnevich back in. That worked. Then he soured on him, took him out. The Tanner's last situation has worked in this series. But at some point, you know, this is a younger league, and a lot of the teams are going in that direction. They're having success. If he's a coach that leans on his vets, then his best players are letting him down right now. And his best players, starting with his goalie and working on through the ranks, and Ryan McDonough, who was great in Round 1, has been very good in this series, but could probably be better in Game 6. Derek Stepan up front, you know, Rick Nash, just to single out some of these guys. If you're going to lean on them, then you get to that old adage of your best players have to be their best in order to win a playoff series. And right now, that's not happening for the Rangers.
But how many times, just playing devil's advocate here, just how many times is it going to take? Like, I understand if it happens once, I get that. But then it happened the second time, and now it's happening a third time. Like, is anything going to change to put Brady Shea on the ice, or is he just going to keep on sticking with his vets?
He's going to go with where his comfort zone is. Most coaches will do that, and he'll have to answer a lot of questions about it when it's over. He's an excellent coach, and the thing is, he's got a team right now that's positioned to move on. And I think the problem with this series, Zach, to be fair, is I think a lot of people underrated Ottawa, and I think I can understand why. But when you look at this, there is another team on the other side that's competing hard, that's very well coached, extremely well structured. Aside from Erik Karlsson, they really don't have, you know, that world-class talent that jumps out at you. They have a lot of guys that are interchangeable, and they're tough to play against. And when you look at the Rangers competing in the Metro Division with all the heavy hitters in the league, and then having to cross over because of the wild card position, I think it's very understandable that if you're a Ranger fan, a Ranger observer, whatever, you would say, aha, okay, after the first round, here's the route right to the conference final. But you got to get through Ottawa. And a lot of people, you know, thought this thing would be over quickly. Guy Boucher has played the underdog card every time he's opened his mouth. And that is a situation where you utilize pressure as your weapon. You reverse it on the other side. And I think that's what he's done here. The Rangers have to have a quality first period tomorrow night to get the pressure kind of off their shoulders. Should Ottawa score first tomorrow, Zach, look out. I see the Rangers seizing up a little bit. It might be difficult for them to navigate through the game.
You would expect Lundqvist to bounce back off the poor performance that he had in Game 5, specifically in the second period, and then also late in the game. What do you expect from the Rangers, though, in that first period tomorrow? I know what you just said, but this has been a team that, you look at Games 3 and 4, they've really put this game out of reach. So do they get off to a hot start tomorrow night?
Well, I think it starts with Hank, right? And if you look at his record in elimination games, especially at home, it's sterling, okay? He's always been great in closeout situations at the Garden. So, you know, in this situation here, there have been a few blips along the way. Remember what Ben Bishop did a couple of years ago, you know, in a Game 7. But usually Lundqvist, by the numbers, is solid. And I think in this series, especially with an extra day of rest, I think it helps him at his age to kind of refocus and get that fatigue out of there. It's a quick turnaround from Thursday night to Saturday afternoon. I don't know if that helps him. He wasn't on. He wasn't sharp in that game. He fought the puck a little bit, made sensational saves, okay. But we saw a sequence there where he's getting frustrated with his defense. Stepan had to come in and kind of settle him down a little bit. There was some yelling going on. That's uncharacteristic. He has to be steady and sharp, and they'll feed off of him, I think, in the first period. If they play like they did in the first round against Montreal at home, and certainly in games 3 and 4, where they get on top of the game, they don't let Ottawa off the hook. They have to be physical. They have to be fast. They have to be able to pressure Ottawa into mismanaging the puck and make it tough on Karlsson. Karlsson, who's not, it was maybe 50%. Was allowed to dictate game number 5, and I think they let him off the hook in that one.
I agree with you. As John Forslund joins us right now, NHL and NBC will be doing the game tomorrow night. Game 6, a potential elimination game for the New York Rangers. You mentioned Stepan in this conversation. I look at Stepan and Hayes, and now it's been two series where they have not been great, and you know they should be playing better. When you watch those two players, what's going on with them right now, and what's Ottawa specifically doing against them?
Well, I think they're doing an excellent job of getting up on them, staying in their face, outskating them in situations. Again, Ottawa's depth down the middle is kind of underrated. I think Brassard has done although you know he gets the goal and he was scoreless in the series. I mean, you guys in this market are well aware of what Derek Brassard brings in the ultimate situations where there's a lot of pressure. So I think he's been an excellent complement down the middle. Mika Zibanejad has emerged as the best center for the Rangers in this series. There's a lot more to give. It doesn't seem like Derek Stepan has the puck a great deal. It doesn't seem like he has a lot of ice to work with, and he's basically been held in check. And Hayes, I thought, was better in Game 5. I thought he came around a little bit in Game 5, made some plays, made a couple of good defensive plays. And, you know, again, if he plays to his potential, which is always a trick for that player, you're onto something. But that's a key matchup. You know, down the middle, I think Kyle Turris has had an excellent series for Ottawa. He's been a prominent player. Sure, he gets the overtime winner, but look how he played in Game 4 in a losing cause when the game was gone. He gets the goal, and he also gets involved out of character in a dust-up there at the end with Glass and everybody else. That's the type of leadership, you know, that Stepan's got to reach for. He's capable of it. He's an excellent player. But, again, their true colors have to show in Game 6.
Do you expect any lineup changes from the Rangers' perspective tomorrow?
Not the word that I got today, and just the word coming out of the practice today doesn't look that way. I don't think so. But again, we'll wait till tomorrow and see. There are not a lot of options, you know, for Vigneault. He's kind of locked into this group. And I think being locked in, we get back to what we talked about at the top of the interview, getting locked into your core. And your core has to be far better. The Rangers have to throw their best game, obviously, at Ottawa, see where it goes. And even with that being said, if they do win, I expect them to win game six, but I do think we flip a coin if this thing goes to Ottawa on Thursday.
Now, when it comes to the end of the game, because we talk about scoring first, and I do believe that's important, specifically an elimination game, because if you let out the first goal, then the building, they have that nervous energy knowing that this could be it. How do the Rangers just buckle down if they only have a one-goal margin going into the third period in game three tomorrow night? In game six, I should say.
Well, again, it's emptying the tank, and it's getting to a transition game, and it's not getting frustrated by, you know, what will be a very, very sound defensive approach from Ottawa if they do have the lead. It's going to be the most difficult thing for the Rangers to get through. It's going to be hard, and they're going to have to play through it. At times, they've done an excellent job with it. They've been able to get to their transitional game in games three and four. They're going to have to be a little bit tougher in terms of blocking shots, which ignite some of their transitional breakouts. You know, all those things are going to be important. But the one thing they're going to have to deal with is they're going to have to be sharper and sharper coming out of their own end with the puck. I think that's the key to getting going against Ottawa when they start dropping back in that 1-3-1 and make it really tough sledding through the middle of the ice. And that's what the Rangers are going to have to deal with.
Wrapping up with John Forslund, who joins us right now. Let's go around the rest of the league. Tonight you have another one of these Game 6 with the Penguins and the Capitals. Capitals get the victory in Game 5 to see another day. Crosby did return for the Penguins. I would have to expect that you expect the Penguins to finish off the Caps tonight. Fair?
No, I don't. I expect Washington to win, and usually
okay.
I'm wrong in these situations. But I really do. I think they have enough from the third period to kind of carry it over. I think a lot of this rests on Holtby. Can Holtby be a pillar of strength? Can he be dominant? Can he be at the elite level, which at times he has in this series, at times he's been way off. But I thought he kind of recaptured all of it in the last game. So I believe that Washington can make this thing very interesting tonight. And again, I think Pittsburgh's the weakness of their team is getting through all the injuries they've had in the back end. They've got some guys playing tonight that are way short of 100%. So even with the group that's dressed, and Trevor Daley's not going to play, so they're going to put Chad Ruedel in, I understand, who's going to play his first playoff game. Can Washington get to that D-core and kind of victimize it?
Let's just say, though, of Washington, if this is the end for tonight, and the two back straight years where they're the President Trophy winners and they can't get to the Eastern Conference Final, we all know everything about it. Ovechkin's never been there in his career. What happens if they lose tonight when you look at this team and the core that they built in Washington?
You're going to have to address it, and they're probably going to have to start breaking it up. I mean, there's something that's just not right. You know, when you win back-to-back President's Trophies, and you have the burn from the year before, and you think that's going to be enough impetus to get you through, and they kind of look the same. They kind of look like they're afraid to take the next step. That's all going to be laid out in front of our eyes tonight. And maybe they can push through this. And if they do, and if they get this done, they'll be on their way. I've always felt that way, and I'm sure I'm not alone. But I think if they don't do it, they're going to have to look long and hard at what they have, and understand that the mix just isn't right in some areas, and they're going to have to get active. They're going to lose a couple players to free agency. They're going to have to address TJ Oshie. He's probably going to hit the jackpot on July 1. There's a lot of things here that could alter their team moving forward, but that proverbial window is starting to close on the Washington Capitals, and this is their Waterloo, so to speak, here tonight.
Now we move on from one team that's had playoff struggles to a coach that he doesn't really struggle that much when he gets to the postseason, looking back at his career with the Islanders and then winning a Stanley Cup with Carolina and then getting the Flyers to the Stanley Cup final where they lost to Chicago in six games. How about the job of Peter Laviolette and what he's been able to do with this Nashville team?
Well, I know him very well, obviously, as you know, with my background and all my years with the Hurricanes, and I know what he can do when he motivates his team. I know what he can do to a club to make them, to a man, believe they can accomplish something together. And once he gets all that chemistry going, he kind of puts his stamp on it with his system, which players love to play. You know, when it's working, it's exciting, it's pressure, it's offensive, it's activation of your defense. You get a lot of scoring from your back end, and he has some elite guys back there that are starting to get the recognition that they deserve. He made a couple of home run trades with Ryan Johansson and P.K. Subban to augment the group. The goaltender's kind of rebuilt himself, and now he's at the top of his game. I've seen this before, and it's a southern market where people go nuts, and that's what they have. They have a huge, huge surge of momentum on their side right now, and they're going to enjoy every minute of this when they get into that conference final, whomever they play. And so Peter has won in the ECHL. He's won in the American Hockey League. He's won in the National Hockey League. He's come close with the Flyers in 2010, and now this. This isn't a shock to me. He's a remarkable coach.
And with what he's been able to do, and I know you say it's not a shock, and we've seen eighth seeds go on runs before. When the Flyers got to the Stanley Cup Final, the Eastern Conference Final, it was a 7-8 matchup in the Eastern Conference Final. But just going into this year's postseason, I saw some people pick the Predators to actually go to the Stanley Cup Final, some to have the upset against Chicago. But did you think they'd be this far going into the postseason when it all started? Or even though you have confidence, could it be a little bit of a surprise that they're here this far now, only four wins away from going to the Stanley Cup Final?
No, you know, to be fair, it's a surprise to everybody. But also to be fair, if you watch closely, you know, they really put things together in the second half of the year, very quietly. And again, it's a division, right? So if you're in the Metropolitan Division, the Central Division, there's so many good teams. You get lost in the shuffle. So unless you're at the top of it, like Minnesota and Chicago, you know, they get all the attention. And then each team had their, you know, little glitches down the stretch. Nashville, steady as she goes, kind of, and even better than that, you know, in the second half of the year. And once they had success in Chicago in the early stages of round one, that's when the bell went off for me, and I was like, wow, this is interesting, because the makeup of the team is very sound, and it is a team. And the other thing that Laviolette has at his disposal are lineup adjustments that he can make from game to game. It's very important. I think they're very deep. I think the acquisitions of grinders like Cody McLeod and Vern Fiddler, the younger players that they have, depending on the opponent, depending upon the game, he can make a change or two, and he can change his lineup and has during the playoffs after wins. See, Alain Vigneault really can't do that. He's locked into his group. There's outside of Buchnevich, you know, what kind of changes is he actually going to make? So teams that can go deep sometimes have that option. The coach has the coach's options of making lineup adjustments that can make a significant difference. I think he's been able to do that. And again, he's last year, in talking with him, I did some of the series. I dropped in on the series in the game four in Nashville last Tuesday night. And talking with him that morning, he kept pointing to the game seven experience they had last year in losing, winning, obviously, and then taking it in the second round in San Jose and taking that to seven games. That experience, coupled with being over their heads in his first year in the playoffs against Chicago, all of that coming together now to help them get to where they're at. And he's like a prophet, because that's exactly what we've seen.
And John, last one before we let John Forslund run. We'll be on the call tomorrow night for the Rangers and Ottawa Senators game. Does a tremendous job, NHL and NBC, and also being the voice of the Carolina hockey team. With Game 7, and you see with what this is going to be with Edmonton and Anaheim, game will be in Anaheim. You had just a fascinating Game 5 and then a blowout yesterday. Give me a thought on this Game 7 between Edmonton and Anaheim.
I like it for Edmonton only because they're so fast, and they have all the I think the battle scars needed now, and also the lessons that have been learned here along the way, and they've shown throughout the series that they're the better team. And now they got it off their backs with that explosion last night. A lot of that also is going to be on both goalies. You know, Talbot's been very good, very sound all season and throughout the playoffs, and he's like a rock back there. Gibson is a hit or miss situation. You know, and to be fair, it was an onslaught, but I think also to in defense of his team and the bad start they got off to in the first 10 minutes, he's got to save at least one of those. You know, and so he wasn't very good either. So John Gibson is still a young goalie and can kind of go through these erratic stages. There's no room for it. Anaheim's going to hear, and they've heard even before Game 6 about their flops in Game 7s, all that history. As much as Randy Carlyle says, it's not on me, it wasn't me coaching, so don't talk to me about Game 7. Well, with all due respect to him, he's not playing the game. The guys that have been flops are the guys that are going to be playing for you. So, yes, you're right, it wasn't you, but the players make the difference, really. The coaches don't actually play. Boudreaux took the hit for all of that. But it's on Getzlaff and Perry and all these guys who had a chance to close it out last night, and we're flat. So I like Edmonton's chances.
John, we appreciate it. Have a good call tomorrow. Thank you.
All right, Zach. Thank you.
There's John Forslund, of course, NHL NBC. We'll do the play-by-play tomorrow, and also in the regular season does tremendous work on the Carolina Hurricanes broadcast.